Thank you for coming to my talk. My name is Matthew Wittall. I'm here representing Kennedy Space Center's SwampWorks and Deep Space Logistics. This work was done in collaboration with Jeff Smith, also at KSC Deep Space Logistics, and Alan Cassell at Ames Research Center. Part of our work at Kennedy Space Center's Deep Space Logistics is examining ways of setting up a supply chain, a way to deliver and retrieve supplies between Earth and the Moon and various other destinations such as Gateway and beyond. There is both historical precedence and modern ongoing efforts to deliver supplies to the lunar surface in various locations, both in support of the Artemis program and for other scientific endeavors. However, part of that supply chain is bringing those supplies back from those destinations and returning them to Earth. This work aims to look at a wide parametric study to establish some kind of bounds for determining what are the available options and what are the best options for retrieving supplies and what is the kind of cost that one should expect. So to put this in more concrete terms, the objective of this work is to identify and weigh various mission concepts and approaches based on the perspective of the mission designer. We also want to quantify these results, and we've restricted these in terms of delta V, time, payload mass, vehicle mass, and complexity. And we'll talk about that last one specifically in a little bit. And finally, we want to engage the community, especially the experts in their fields, the mission designers, the kind of people who come to this very conference. So first of all, let's name our assumptions here. Well, we used historical precedents to kind of constrain a lot of these trajectories and vehicle descriptions and masses, things like the Luna missions, the Chang'e spacecraft, Hayabusa, Stardust, and CLPS contracts that are issued as part of the Artemis program. We also used the Large Orbital Robotic Interface, or LORI, which is expected to be placed on board the Dragon XL, the logistics spacecraft, and used the Gateway Destination Orbit Model and Deep Space Logistics Contract to constrain some of the Gateway aspects, things where we're trying to bring back supplies from the Gateway. We also mentioned Starship several times, which is kind of the pie in the sky, the ultimate goal, have the super heavy launch capability where you can just throw in whatever cargo you want and bring it back. And we'll talk about that more in detail. But in order to constrain that, we used NASA's HLS contract and the ongoing estimates that we kind of get for something like a super heavy launch vehicle, some kind of robust reusable spacecraft to and from the Moon. The ballistic return trajectory, a variation of the ballistic lunar transfer, uses a gravitational model that includes the Earth, the Moon, the Sun, Jupiter, and Saturn. Now that ballistic return trajectory is of specific interest to us, especially in terms of returning supplies from the Gateway. As you can see from this table on the right, the total delta V required from the departure of Gateway all the way back into Earth reentry is very, very low. There are some trajectories that get it up to 100 meters per second, but most of them are well below 50 meters per second, which is negligible. You can do that with electric propulsion. And in fact, these delta V estimates are, in a practical terms, free, because it already requires 10 to 15 meters per second to safely depart the NRHO to begin with. And as we'll see in the next couple of slides, those very small, sub 1 meter per second burns can significantly alter where your spacecraft re-enters. However, the ballistic return trajectory comes at a cost. Since you can significantly change the destination or spacecraft with very low amounts of thrust, they're very sensitive to thruster noise, and you can expect to have more than just a couple mid-course corrections sometime between departure and re-entry. They also take quite a bit of time. You know, as you can see here, between 100 and 150 days between departure from the NRHO and re-entering Earth. Now that may or may not be a problem depending on the size and demands of the spacecraft. In regards to the ballistic return trajectory's re-entry conditions, as I mentioned, they're very sensitive to small inputs of thrust. We see here the Earth-Sun rotating frame and Earth-centered Earth-fixed inertial frames. In the Earth-Sun rotating frame, groups of BLT departures separated by one orbital period of the NRHO are color-coded in blue, green, yellow, and red. They re-enter at what seems to be a very similar location. However, when looking at the Earth-centered Earth-fixed frames, we can see that their re-entry point, separated by a few days, is significantly altered. However, what this does mean is that pretty much any given ballistic return trajectory can result in a desirable re-entry vector. All right, now let's examine our parameter space. We considered a lot of different concepts here, so I'm going to go through them one by one. The first group of mission concepts that we considered was the Lunar Direct mission concept. Now, this is a trajectory that starts on the lunar surface, somewhere around the equator, facing the Earth and the Sun when the angle between the Moon, the Earth, and the Sun is at 180 degrees. So the first sub-bullet here is the CLPS contract. Now, we've already mentioned that's Commercial Lunar Payload Services. If you get one metric ton to the surface, then we can extrapolate on what kind of thrust you need to get out into orbit and return to Earth using the aforementioned trajectory. Now, this results in about 10 kilograms of returned payload back to Earth from the lunar surface. And there's a bit of wiggle room there depending on your architecture and given assumptions, but we're mostly rounding to an order of magnitude here. A standalone mission concept is similar to CLPS, but you're using as much payload as you can get using the heaviest available launch vehicle today. And that puts you at about 1,500 kilograms, or 1.5 tons. And the third concept for Lunar Direct is something like Starship, or another super heavy launch vehicle. You don't have to design your own vehicle, you're pretty much just a box in the cargo hold of Starship. And so we assume that that box is about 100 kilograms and the payload's about 1 ton. The next group of concepts exploit the ballistic return trajectory that we mentioned a little bit ago. The first being CLPS, same thing as you did before, but you know, use the ballistic return trajectory. It might save you a few kilograms, but it's kind of hard to tell because it depends on architecture. However, it does require less delta V to get you there, and there's a bit less stress in the vehicle, so those factors are considered in the cost matrix that we'll see in a little bit. The next concept is a ride-along, in other words, something that is external to something like the logistics module, other supply or cargo vehicle, something unmanned that is departing from the gateway and returning to Earth, or swings by Earth. Now you see this illustrated in the right, where something like the logistics module could have some parasitic module that departs as it approaches Earth, and the logistics module itself could either burn up in the atmosphere, which is the red trajectory, or do an Earth flyby and dispose of itself in heliocentric space, which is the blue trajectory. Neither of these options require any difference in thrust. For both this ride-along and the next concept, which is a free flyer, it's constrained to the maximum mass of the lorry, and that's about 150 kilograms. Now, the free flyer concept is similar to the ride-along, where you are at first a parasitic module to the logistics module, but the difference is that when the logistics module departs from the gateway, you separate soon after. The final one is a Starship, so the benefit of the Starship is that, again, it's huge. And that you have some method of delivering 1,000 kilograms or 1 ton of cargo from the lunar surface to Gateway and then transfer it over to Starship, where you then perform a ballistic return trajectory. Again, I know a lot of assumptions going into this, as assumptions with all this, but really this is just a first pass at comparing a lot of different options. There are two other concepts that we considered. So if you have your own specially contracted vehicle, then you depart Gateway with whatever your payload is and return to Earth. This is around 100 kilograms or so of material. Now, of course, the difference with Gateway Direct is that you have fast return back to Earth. It takes about 3 days as opposed to 100 to 150 for the ballistic return trajectory. The final one is Starship Direct. So if you landed a Starship on the South Pole of the Moon and you're departing directly from the South Pole over to Earth using a 3 day transfer, something again very similar to a fast return like Orion would perform. All right, so let's talk briefly about the metrics considered for scoring these various concepts. Now, these metrics are all from the perspective of the mission designer that wants to get something from the moon. It's everything that happens after you start your journey back to Earth as your own independent spacecraft. So we're summing up all the delta V of all the maneuvers that you have to do on your own. If you're departing from the lunar surface, that includes that lunar surface burn. However, if you're the parasitic module onto the logistics module, then all that's considered is that initial separation burn and whatever is needed to do mid-course corrections. Mission duration, again, this is after separation. Whenever you're doing an independent, your own thing, that's the mission time considered here. Not the mission to be delivered, not the time spent docked at Gateway, not the time spent on the lunar surface, the return trajectory only. The third one is vehicle mass. So how much mass goes into your entire vehicle, including fuel, including systems and everything. So this the thinking behind this cost is how much is it going to get cost you to deliver it to the gateway or deliver it to where you need to go before you even have it coming back. Then there's the payload mass. Now for us at NASA, that's what we really want. We want that cargo back. We want that sample back. And the final one is complexity. And that's a bit more nuanced. So let's talk about that. Complexity, again, is scored from the perspective of the mission designer, the person who's designing this cargo transfer vehicle that they want to get back from the moon or from Gateway. The first one is communications. Now, depending on the mission architecture, there's going to be a different demand on communications. Something that's a free flyer doing a ballistic return trajectory that obviously has much more demand placed on its communication system, either as a parasitic module or as a free flyer, it still requires a lot more communication to make sure that its state and attitude is where it should be. Now, the interfaces category talks about how many times you have to interact with another vehicle. So if it's just cargo, then there's no interaction, right? You're just something in the cargo bay. Now, if you have to enter the atmosphere, that adds complexity. That's something else that you have to consider, an interface. Most of these, of course, have to have some kind of re-entry component, with the exception of the Starship concept, which takes care of it for you because you're not designing that vehicle. If you have to launch from the surface, that places more burden on your spacecraft. If you have to interact with the gateway or the logistics module, anytime you have an interface with something else. The third one is GNNC. Again, with this weak stability boundary, any maneuvers you make out there, even less than 1 meter per second, can have a huge impact on your trajectory. So if you have to perform a lot of burns or maintain your trajectory with very high precision, that's penalized here. Now in the vehicle category, this is kind of a catch-all for complexity of the vehicle. So if you just have to have a re-entry shield, then that's pretty easy. If you're just a cargo bay, it's pretty easy. But the more robust your overall vehicle must be, if it has to have its own navigation system or if it's just tying into something else, the more precise, the more complicated your vehicle is, the more it's penalized here. Risk is a little bit different. Risk considers how much risk is imposed on other high priority assets. So an interface with a logistics module is lower risk than interface with gateway. Even if it's the same lorry, the risk is higher with gateway than it is with the logistics module. All right, so all of these can be added up to a maximum score of 100, between 0 and 20 for 5 categories. Now for the formulation process of how we develop this weight matrix, it's just a simple cost function. I think most of us here know what a terminal cost function is, and that's displayed here. That's our J term, that 1/2 P transpose QP, where Q is your weight matrix and P is your vector containing all of your different parameters. Usually this is a state. In this case, this is our vector containing all of our mission parameters. So delta V, payload and vehicle masses, time and complexity. That Q matrix is tuned to quantify these different parameters and weigh them. All right, so thanks for bearing with me through all that background. Now let's finally talk about some results. So of course, shown here in all three cases, Starship is a very desirable option. However, in the absence of something that is that reusable, robust, and proven, then we do have other options, and the best among those is easily Eclipse. Despite having a lower total payload value, the flexibility and availability of Eclipse is desirable. Of course, it's short mission time, and availability is a very desirable option. You can see the ride-along concept when compared with the Free Flyer, although similar in mass and maximum return payload and a lot of other ways, are significantly different when you consider the need to do all these maneuvers and deep space communication. For experienced mission designers, this is kind of self-evident. But when comparing a large number of studies, having this kind of comparison might be useful as a first pass. There's some things I'd like to point out when considering these results. First of all, Starship, in this case, isn't considered a real solution. While the cost per kilogram of launching a Starship is much lower, the overall amount of weight for a Starship is still very high, so cost-sharing options would have to be something considered. Until more information can become available, we might want to introduce something like technology development risk. You know, Starship introduces a lot of unproven technologies, where something like Eclipse mission does not. Now, that being said, small payload or small payload delivery services may still be more valuable to some customers when compared against something as large and robust as Starship, despite having no cost to vehicle development. And that's because small payload services such as Eclipse can land anywhere on the lunar surface and deliver small payloads that would otherwise cost an entire Starship. They also might offer more frequent returns, especially as the deep space infrastructure develops further. Now that, and a few other things we talked about before, kind of brings us to estimating the dollar amount. Now this is even more complicated and requires more assumptions than even we've used here. It's because there's not a lot of precedence for having a return sample infrastructure. When developing these kind of supply chains, it's only been one-off missions that have delivered supplies from the lunar surface back to Earth. And most of that's been very small payloads, things like samples or right along to the Apollo programs. However, with the recent solicitations and awarding of several Eclipse contracts, we can kind of get an estimate of what it would look like in terms of cost per return kilogram. And it's still quite high, and it varies within the same order of magnitude, but still varies significantly. And we want to get that cost down. And we can do that with more missions, more people on board, and opening up this kind of deep space supply chain to commercial competition. Now, as we go forward, this is kind of the first paper in a series. As we develop this deep space infrastructure and get a better understanding of the value of these different mission concepts and architectures, then we can further refine our work and present some harder numbers in the future. Part of that future work is to refine our assumptions about the supply chain based in part on the feedback that we're hoping to get from the community. We also want to refine our trajectories and maybe exploit that interplanetary superhighway. And of course, we want to refine those dollar amounts that we kind of estimated out with the previous slide to give more concrete numbers and get a better understanding of how much this stuff is going to cost, both now and in the near future. Thank you for watching my video presentation, and I will be happy to take any of your questions or comments at the Q&A session at 2:40 p.m. on Tuesday, August 10th. Thanks.